Everyone, let's start for today. My name is Chris Vitale. As I think a lot of you know, I've seen a lot of you before at these seminars. I'd like to welcome you again on behalf of Pratt Institute's Graduate Program in Media Studies to Fernando Zalamea's seminar, GROTHENDIECK and the Theory of Contemporary Transgression. This is the sixth and final session before our closing ceremonies on Saturday. Tonight, Fernando will be talking about Warburg in relation to the topics he's been developing in regard to Novalis, the Atlas of Transformation, and link this up to the glass bead group. But he's going to be framing this in regard to the sheaves paradigm of GROTHENDIECK, which for Fernando serves as an antidote to a wide variety of contemporary issues and impasses. In terms of our Saturday events, I will be giving a talk at 4:30 in room 702 upstairs on Saturday. It will be entitled Why Zalamea Matters, Philosophy, Mathematics, Media, and Culture. And I'll be working to situate Fernando's project in regard to contemporary trends from Ernesto Laclau's work on empty signifiers, Gilles Deleuze's notions of transcendental empiricism, psychoanalytic and Marxist concepts, and various other paradigms for attempting to produce a cognitive mapping in our transmodern contemporary situation. After that, we'll have a short half-hour break, and then from 6 to 9, back in this main room, we will have our roundtable in which a variety of figures will speak about how their work relates to Fernando's project. We may or may not have Reza Negarastani coming. We will probably know when you know, but at the last moment, it seems like there has been an impasse in his situation, so we are not 100% sure. Robin McKay will be joining us by Skype. Garino Mazzola, who Fernando spoke about yesterday, he will be joining us. Fabien Jarreau, the art historian, will also be joining us. And Fernando, I believe, will be speaking about some of his work today. Yes?
Yes.
I will also be on stage, and we will be then in conversation with Fernando on a series of questions he has posed us in regard to his six provocative seminars. So in coordination with the New Center for Research and Practice, who has helped us to live stream this on the internet and video archive this all. And once again, thanks to the grad program in Media Studies, I'd like to welcome our lecturer for his final installment of this incredible series. With great thanks, Fernando Zalamea.
Thanks, Chris, for the presentation and for all your enthusiasm. So I invite you particularly for the round table. I think that the round table will be the most important thing of these meetings, particularly because we will have very bright people there which are really changing our understanding of the world today. McKay, Vitale, Mazzola, Giro. And I will just be asking questions to them. In fact, it will not be, I hope, on my work. It will be more on the general understanding of our world together and of their work, certainly. I tried to do in the previous session some introductions to the Collapse project, to the Networkologies project of Vitali, the Topos of Music of Mazzola, and today I will be introducing very briefly also the work of Fabien Giraud and his colleagues in France in England around some new forms of understanding art history. Today then I will be finishing with the fourth great invention of GROTHENDIECK, going to the very basics always. The four of them were very lightly and very synthetically introduced here. And there is a lot of very, very important mathematics behind, which I have not spoken about. But GROTHENDIECK has certainly been for mathematics a great paradigm change in a lot of senses. And things have been happening after he retired in 1970 from the mathematical world between quotes. In fact, he did a lot of mathematics afterwards, and it seems that in his manuscripts, which are a lot of pages, there is still a little of beautiful and new mathematics to be understood for the 21st century. So GROTHENDIECK will change, has been changing, and will change more and more the panorama of mathematics. And one hopes that if he changes mathematics in a very strong way, and mathematics spreads on the world, which is always happening to great philosophers, then GROTHENDIECK will be an important figure for the 21st century, well behind the mathematics. So I will be talking today about the fourth one, which are the constructions of motives, which is a very simple idea, very complicated in the details. The very simple idea of GROTHENDIECK is that behind you have, remember, you have one topological space, one idea of continuity. With that idea of continuity, you try to produce several constructions, iterated and discrete constructions that will try to capture your topological space at the beginning. Those are called the homologies and cohomologies. And afterwards, when you multiply the topologies and you multiply the homologies, then you have a lot of variations between the homologies. And GROTHENDIECK had this wonderful and very GROTHENDIECKian idea that behind the multiplicity of the cohomologies, there were like archetypes that he called the motives, from which all the cohomologies would proceed afterwards. So it was a very conjectural idea in the 60s and 70s when he began to write about it. It became truly completely mathematical thanks to Wobowski again, which is probably one of the greatest GROTHENDIECK mathematicians who have really understand GROTHENDIECK at the bottom of his many revolutions. So I will speak about this basic idea that behind the cohomologies you have some motives. And this is a very musical idea for GROTHENDIECK. It was like a metaphor which was fundamental for him. You have a theme and variations. The variations are the cohomologies, the theme should be the motive, which spreads on the different variations. So you have a very simple idea that behind the types, you should have an archetype, or behind the variations, you should have a theme. And going back and forth, you have music going around. That music could be, if you go from the theme to the variations, it could be some sort of modulation. If you take the variations, you harmonize them, then you can get some sort of theme, initial theme. So there is a back and forth between harmonization and modulation. And that middle ground was very interesting for GROTHENDIECK. And we will try to work on that vague idea, which comes then from music and mathematics, and becomes very theoretical in one moment, thanks to Wobowski and the people around him. Great school of Russian mathematicians have been on the forefront of understanding GROTHENDIECK. GROTHENDIECK has spread a lot in a lot of places. He spread in a very particular and very original way in Russia. So we will come to this basic idea that we have some theme and variations to study, and in the middle some going back and forth between harmonizations and modulations in between. As I was playing with these general ideas, GROTHENDIECK's structure to put some natural bridges between one of the forefathers of modernity, Novalis, on which we have been coming again and again and again, and we will continue to be coming again and again and again. I think that Novalis is probably one of the greatest contemporary thinkers for today. He's really an astounding imagination, which is extremely important for us today. And I will take, as I was doing with the other sessions, one outstanding thinker at the beginning of the 20th century, end of the 19th century, had put him in parallel with some of the things which are being done today. So I will take Warburg and contrapose Warburg with the glass bead group in France and England. And at the end, I will pose like the main problem of all these things. there is a strong main problem, a very simple problem to state, and it seems extremely complicated to solve. So let's go back to Novalis again. Always Novalis. Novalis is always there, and I hope it will be always there afterwards. He's very little read. I hope that one of the things that comes after my talks is that you are going to read Novalis a lot more. He's very, very interesting, extremely interesting. Let's read some of his sentences for today. The imagination will become simultaneously an outward direct sense and an inward indirect sense. We have talked last time about the contraposition between soul and body, and we have talked several times about contrapositions between day and light, between negativity and positivity. This sentence, if you read it in a more mathematical way, in which you have in fact complex numbers behind them, the direct is the real numbers, the indirect sense is the complex numbers, the imaginary numbers, then you have some sort of complexification of imagination. Imagination could be and should be understood through complex numbers. Florensky did that very carefully in his book about imaginaries in geometry. We read some of those parts in one of the sessions before. So Florensky will take this sentence very seriously and convert it like in a great book, which was like a comment on Riemann. So Riemann is also another person which has been always behind the lot of things that I have been saying. For Novalis, then, the imagination should be something already complex in itself, with a positive and negative sense, and those positive and negative senses can be well defined with complex theoretic tools. Florensky is behind that. Second sentence, the expanses of space and the chasm of thought, only the imagination, like the shadow of a giant intelligence, is able to bridge. The importance of imagination as a shadow of the intelligence. We have called that the shadow of reason. We have called that in Spanish, which is probably the best language in which you can say that, the razón and corazón duality, in which you have really a co-idea of intelligence taken in the sensibility. And the imagination is the one of the essential bridges to produce that going back and forth in the sense of an expansion of space. Imagination expands our space. That is also very close to what Valéry, to the project of Valéry. Valéry is also behind this kind of things that will happen afterwards in his gigantic notebooks that we were just beginning to unravel last time. In the Cahier, he said something like, the better part of intelligence is, if I quote right, quote, the art of making visible what is invisible. The better part of intelligence is the art of making visible what is invisible. It's an outstanding and general idea which has been happening, you know, in all our civilization, but the instruments are every time more interesting. The instrumentation to make that visibility, to make the invisibility visible, is something very important for Grothendieck also. For Grothendieck, there was some kind of a mission or a sense in his working, in his mathematical working, to show things that are usually impossible to see. Or he had a lot of metaphors with music to make us hear things that usually we cannot hear very well. The imagination is very important in that bridge. The understanding imagination, the third sentence, is the business of designating in general, of signalizing. That is completely Peirce, if you see it. You have there your Persian semiotics working, And the imagination is just the understanding of a general semiotics, a general way of studying signals. Those signals can be from everywhere. We have though we have seen those signals a lot in mathematics. We have them. We have seen them in poetry, in art, in literature, in music. Everywhere they are, and that that is also like a kind of a program. So you have here in these simple sentences, very short synthetic and strokes of genius in which you have in the first sentence, you have one good part of Florensky, in the second sentence, you have one good part of Valéry, in the third, you have Peirce, etc. Everywhere up to now, the transfusion idea. We have insisted a lot of times on the trans here. The trans in every possible modulation of the trans idea. It's also like a motive and variations for our series of talks. You have the trans, and the trans can be modulated in a lot of ways. Certainly by transits, we have gone a lot on transits, transfusions. We have gone a lot on of transformations. The idea to call our era transmodern, making an homage to Rosa Maria Rodriguez Magda, who 30 years ago was saying, we have to change our things. Our age is not more postmodern. It's going to some sort of transmodernity in which the transmodernity goes back in a very strong way to the founders of modernity. So there is a continuity with a lot of variations, very interesting variations, 19th century variations, postmodern variations, transmodern variation, etc. But we are, I think, we are still on the same stronghold of modernity. We have not gone still away from that. I think, on the contrary, we are coming back to the founders of modernity, like Novalis, but with new tools, new different perspectives, which are very interesting. For Novalis, the direct, indirect, and substantial words should become harmonious. There is a harmony between the translations, between the movements. There is a poetic form of the word in which the soul and the reason should come together. Novalis was telling us that last sentence, the true scientific spirit has up to now especially reigned among mathematicians. It's nice for the mathematicians. He was reading a lot of mathematics in that moment. He was reading of everything, but he had a good grasp of what was going on in mathematics. But we are still at the end of the 18th century. We have not come in that moment to the really mathematical important things that will come afterwards. Novalis didn't know about, of course, of the great mathematicians that will come afterwards, him, and Galois, Riemann, and Poincaré, the fundamental triad of the 19th century. Then you have Cantor, Hilbert, Gödel, the fundamental triad for the beginning of the 20th century. Those gigantic mathematicians that have changed completely our world were impossible to imagine for Novalis. So if he was saying that that nice sentence for mathematicians in that moment, now things are even much better. Mathematics now is much more interesting than it was at the moment of Novalis, much more interesting every time. Mathematics is really in a moment of fantastic inventivity, imagination, creativity. And Diodonné, one of the great mathematicians of the 20th century, said already that in the 60s, 99% of important mathematics were being done in that moment. In those years, 99% of good, real, important mathematics were done in the 50s, 60s. Imagine today. Things are even growing and growing and growing, and mathematics is very, very alive. So instead of thinking in a very strange postmodern way in which things are going to be dead, mathematics is not at all postmodern in that sense. It's very, very modern, transmodern, whatever. It's completely alive. So making like a synthesis of those ideas, there are residues. And the residues, in fact, can be understood in a lot of ways. So I will be stressing myself today on this simple idea that when some residues are interesting, the residues should be rich enough or dense enough to reflect in a good, complete, or at least the best complete way, the context in which they live. We will talk about good residues or dense residues or rich residues in which the remainder is good enough to capture in a complete or the best complete possible way the information around him. That happens explicitly in complex variable, which should be still this. I am insisting on this several times because I think that complex variable should be for our world like a good paradigm, a good metaphoric paradigm in which it should spread to culture in general, to cultural studies, to philosophy, to literature, to poetry, to art. It is a gigantic sense of how things are being done in mathematics. It's like the heart of mathematics in many senses. So in complex variable, you have a very nice theorem, which is called the residue theorem of Cauchy, in which you say that if you have a good function, the good function is completely in one point, the good function is completely determined by behavior in a neighborhood around the point. So in when things are harmonious enough and the variable complex variable is perhaps the best example in mathematics of harmony everywhere. It's completely harmonious. When you have good harmonies, the residues and the context are very related together. Is that possible to be done outside mathematics? I think that has been already done by Novalis, but the great example for us should be the Walter Benjamin, the archives project. He had this wonderful idea that to understand the general panorama of Paris in the 19th century, you could know that panorama going to the residues, to the ruins of things in history. Good ruins and dense ruins will give you a good panorama of the world. In fact, he had a strong idea in one moment. I don't know what is the name exactly in English. It's something called like the apokatastasis, in which there is some moment in the history and the development of time in which the moment is so dense, or the neighborhood around the moment is so dense, that it can reflect all the past. That can happen in reality, perhaps sometimes, when we have some kind of visions or some kind of true understanding of a context. It happens that sometimes we have some sort of illumination, which that illumination explains for the first time for us everything. It seems completely clear. I will give one example in a moment related to art. So in residuation and harmonization, we have two of the three basic constructions that are coming with Grothendieck's motifs. The residues should be the different homologies or cohomologies. If they are well harmonized together, you will get the motifs behind them, the archetype. So let's see what Warburg says about that. Warburg, of course, you know him very well, one of the greatest historians of the end of 19th century and beginning of the 20th century. Strangely enough, his greatest work has not been translated into English either, the Atlas Mnemosyne. There is a translation of his papers by the Getty Center, but his great atlas hasn't been translated. There are several translations, good translations in Italian, in French, but strangely enough, the best by far translation is a Mexican one by Linda Baez, an extraordinary scholar on Warburg. She has done the facsimile edition of the introduction, an annotated transcription. She has put together all the panels of the Warburg of the Atlas Mnemosyne, and he has done a very careful annotated explanation of all the panels. It's a wonderful presentation. I would like to present that here. This is on the side. This is something which is strange for me. It is clear that the English is in principle the scholars' languages and things like that. But for example, of the people that we have talked to in these sessions, Peirce, of course, an American scholar, writes in English. But it seems that if he had wrote in Chinese, because the influence of Peirce in American philosophy is very, very small. It's strange because it's really a gigantic genius which has a lot of influence in the world and very little influence in America. It's strange for me. Valéry, the Valéry Cahiers have been translated, part of them in English, but it's just like a selection that one of the scholars on Valéry did on the Pleiad in the 70s. And the gigantic output of the Cahiers is very well hidden. Florensky, very little translations, and Valéry and Warburg, not translated, the Atlas Mnemosyne. So we have very, very strong, important thinkers, I think, that strangely enough have not been translated into English. Perhaps it will be the time to begin some of these great translations. This is one that should be done very quickly. It's incredible that the Atlas Mnemosyne has not been translated and published in English. There are small things in the internet, but not a good presentation. And instead, for example, the Italian one, Italy, which one would say very small country, small culture, very ahead of, way back of the world. They have the best school on Florensky, probably one of the best schools on Warburg. Good, extremely good translations of all of them. And for me, for example, they have the best Peirce scholarship in the world, which is something very strange. They have 15 young students, PhD students on Peirce, which are extremely bright, and they are doing things which are very, very different from the ones that have been done before. So the Italians are an example of thinking in a different way. I have stressed a lot of times that the French also think in a different way, and probably you remember the Goethe dictum, something like mathematicians are like Frenchmen. When you say something to them, they translate it into their own language, and instantly it becomes something completely different. Okay, the famous sentence by Goethe, in which it's true. The French are very strange people. They think in widely original ways. Of course, they have had a lot of influence. The Italians know it's strange because they should. Well, let's go back to Warburg. So Warburg had this great atlas. I will show some images afterwards. Some parts of the introduction. I will read some part of the introduction. A vegetal physiology of circulation and augmentation of fluids is only revealed to whom examines life in the fabric of its underground roots. It's incredible if you read that after what we have been reading of Novalis. You have all Novalis there. And it is not an explicit reference to Novalis, but it's the mind which is going there. It's the negative combustion, the fermentation. You remember that idea of Novalis that there is a space if I remember, is a space of life between in which the soul is a ferment. Those kind of things, that circulation, going to the deep things, and a space of negativity, very important for Novalis, very important for Warburg, extremely important for Grothendieck, the space of negativity. One has to descend to the bottom of the instinctive complexity of human spirit intertwined with a chronological stratified matter. You have to go to the bottoms. You have to go to the negative, strange things that happen in the human spirit, to the complexity. You have to descend. In fact, you have to go to the depths in order to afterwards go to the mythical symbols, to the ascent of the human soul. So we have seen it as a systematic way of thinking in Grothendieck. In Grothendieck, systematically, you have to go in the ascent and descent. The ascent and descent between the very concrete and the very abstract, that systematically brings you a lot of new mathematical tools, very interesting mathematical tools. Here are some of the diagrams of Warburg, in which behind the polarities, as I have been saying in a lot of the talks before, behind the polarities, what is important is what is the mediation, what happens in the middle. So you have here some of the manuscripts of Warburg saying that you have to look at what is behind that. So behind the polar function, there is an oscillation between the impulsive fantasy and some soothing or calming reason. Our corazón and razón, our sensibility and reasonability, they oscillate all the time. And that oscillation is fundamental. You cannot stay only on the side of reason. You cannot stay only on the side of good analytical clearness. You need also the counterpart, the synthetic vagueness. There is some sort of oscillation also between some sort of suffering and some sort of action. The last sentence is the beginning of the introduction of the Atlas Mnemosyne. It has become a very classical and very important sentence for art theory. The conscious creation of a distance between oneself and the exterior world may well be considered the founding act of human civilization. We have seen that yesterday, for example, in the Atlas of Transformation, how you have to work against yourself, against me. You have to introduce the world, and in that back and forth, in that oscillation, in that emotion or tragic polarity, creativity emerges. In fact, the third diagram there on the right is amazing for us. If you look at that diagram and all the things that I have been saying about Grothendieck, you see there explicitly and completely a shift. You have a shift there. You have the shift of emergence of fibers over one point. Going from the top to the bottom, you have the collapse also. The collapse of the school of Mackay and Negaristani, the decay from which after one negative combustion, you create new things. Or the Atlas of Transformation people also in the Czech Republic were saying, in order to create, you have to disintegrate before. So there is a collapse and an elevation, which is very clearly drawn there in that diagram. So that's, if we were a little amazed yesterday with Valéry doing a diagram of the Riemann surface, here we have Warburg doing a diagram of a shift. The Atlas of Mnemosyne is, after a great theoretical introduction, is putting together with only images a history of art, and behind that a history of civilization in general. You put several images together, and behind the images there appear new paths. Completely new paths, new gluings between the objects. Those new gluings, those new paths say to you a lot of things that you cannot say either in words or either with our usual languages, but there you have some sort of new understanding of images thanks to a new relationship, a new way of interweaving the images, which is completely shift-like. It's behind this you have a strong shift also going around. The problem is how to glue coherently different images in order to produce a new understanding. That can be done systematically, and Warburg was very good at that. He had a wonderful visual imagination, and with that visual imagination, he found very interesting and completely unexpected correlations between different works of art in the history. One of those tables, the third one, talks about the grisaille, the interstices, the passages, the reflections. I want to bring here one show that impacted me a lot last week. It's a show of Rebecca Quaidman. It's probably you know her. It's an artist, a New York artist, which has been doing systematically also over years, at least I think that since 2001, systematically over years, she has been doing a fantastic and wonderful project, which is extremely Grothendieckian without her knowing so, of course, of Grothendieck. In which sense? She goes to places, look at the place. She has a wonderful visual imagination, local imagination of the place. She produces works of art related to that place, which are extremely local. And also, she has a very interesting methodology to produce the works. I will speak of that in a moment. But she has different shows around the world and around the spaces. Those are different local perspectives. And she has the idea of producing with them like a book of different local approximations to put them all together in some sort of book where you have all the leaves of the leaves or different shows putting together in one single construction. If you see that, for us, that's a completely Riemann construction. It's a Riemann surface that she is doing. She's doing a Riemann surface without knowing about Riemann, or she's producing like a general Grothendieck topos without knowing about Grothendieck. She's doing it in a very artistic, very philosophical, and very mystical way, very interesting, in which the different localities should be glued together in some sort of global understanding. The global understanding is also some sort of archetype. In fact, Peirce, the mother of Quaidman, is a good Peirce scholar, perhaps she knows about this. Peirce had an idea of a general book in which you have the different possible worlds in different leaves of the book. The different leaves of the book are patched together through some moments, some sort of Kripke model, but in a book, a more beautiful construction, which is related to the existential graphs of Peirce, the gamma graphs of Peirce. The model of the gamma graph of Peirce is a book in which you develop the different leaves. So there is this idea behind that, behind her work, in which local and global are beginning to be mixed together and begin to have a strong tension. But then afterwards, she has a lot of things which are extremely Grothendieckian in our sense. She has this wonderful idea also that when she has produced some kind of work, then she takes parts of it, and she develops it in a line, in a visual line, in which the first work of art is like cutted, and it iterated, and then iterated again with some variations, with some modulations, in which you have also like the archetype, which is variated, or the theme, which is variated with musical things. I saw her, thanks to my publisher at Sequence, Catherine Picard, who showed me her work last week, I was really amazed. She has a show now going on Orchard Street, I think is the name of the street, and in which she has found something very beautiful. It's a wonderful example of how Warburg works. She, it's an homage to Benjamin, to Walter Benjamin also, who has been like a very important person to us in our talks. You remember that Benjamin had this idea that in some moment of history, in one moment of history, there will be something very special, very essential, in order to have the apocatastasis of it. That has been drawn in a beautiful picture that Benjamin had in his house, the Angelus Novus of Paul Klee. You have heard or seen it probably a lot of times. It's an angel which is waking with wings against the progress of history, and looking backwards and putting all the development and the trash of civilization in one moment. So she did a careful research of the Angelus Novus of Paul Klee, and she found something that no one has found before her. She found in the backwards of the Angelus Novus drawing, which is in fact in Israel. So she went to Israel and she went to the library and looked carefully what was happening there. She found an inscription, an LC inscription, on the bottom of the part of the drawing, which seemed something incomprehensible. It was a residue of something. We didn't know what it was. So she looked, she worked around. She found out finally that behind the Angelus Novus, there was a small like a sketch of Lucas Cranach. And in the Lucas Cranach sketch, she found then the whole history developing in that very symbol, in that very residue. So you have here an example in which a very small residue taken seriously by an extraordinary artist brings you back all the history, all the hard history, and he has produced a show and on the Orchard Street in which she is making us see that fantastic interstices, reflections, passages behind the world. So things are happening in now, even now, in very, very interesting ways, very different, unexpected ways. Probably she will be a little strange that GROTHENDIECK may be behind her work. So let's go back to GROTHENDIECK then. The motifs paradigm. It was this extremely simple idea again, that you have on the right a lot of structures, schemes, topos in particular. You have then the invariants for them, the cohomologies. And then you want to see if behind them you have still an archetype, the motifs. So is there an archetype behind all these things? It's like this LC residue, which will be rich enough in order to reconstruct all the history behind. That has been done mathematically. There are a lot of mathematics behind this. Very, very strong, very technical mathematics, very beautiful and difficult mathematics. And essentially, well, I will come back to that afterwards. Essentially then, the idea is the GROTHENDIECK musical idea that there is a base motif between on which if you have some modulations, the tempo, the key, the mode, will give you the different ways of understanding the musical object. There you have GROTHENDIECK at one of his blackboards in Montreal when he was going away of mathematics, at least of the viewable mathematics. He was a mathematician of such a kind that he never really stopped doing mathematics. These are the basic polarities in Warburg sense, sense, the polarities or the dialectics. On the first part of left part of the slide, you have in the far left you have like the integral or the archetype, and in the second column you have the types. So these are some of the great constructions in mathematics: how the many is related to the one, how the discrete is related to the continuous, etc., etc., etc. What is interesting is that in mathematics you have a lot of back and forths. There is no one special natural way to do things. You have, for example, the idea that if you have the discrete, then you can complete the discrete to become continuous. That's the Cantor construction of the real line. But if you do that, then you don't know more or less nothing about the real numbers. They can be whatever you want. The cardinal of the real numbers can be whatever you want. So that construction is still very open. It's still very incomplete. Or you can go the other way around. You take the continuous as well your basic construction, like in the intuitionistic Brouwer understanding of the world, and then you begin to make cuts on the continuum, and then you get the discrete. Different approaches. Or you have Peirce approach, which is even more interesting and more strange. The Peirce's continuum is something which is very, very far behind Cantor's real line and very, very far behind the Brouwer's continuum. Something very, very strange that opens up in the future. It's greater than any cardinal that you want. It has a super multitude on it. It has some modal logics internal to them. It seems a very abstract and very philosophical construction, but there is a very natural model to the Peirce continuum that was found 2 or 3 years ago. So you have this, going back and forth. In that going back and forth, what happens in the middle, I say, is always the important things. And particularly, you have the motifs, which should project on the different cohomologies. If you are interested, for example, in Novalis, you will look at the minerals, which are behind life. Or if you are interested in the Warburg understanding, you will look at the bottoms, at the negative bottoms, in fact, which are behind the stratifications. And always there is some sense of depth. In all these thinkers, the world is very complex, extremely complex. There is a strong multi-layered understanding of the world. There is a depth behind that. That depth is very important because our world today tends to be very superficial. So it's a very interesting counterpart, which is also Grothendieckian. Grothendieckian, as you know, Grothendieck was, as you know, was, we were talking about that in the first two sessions, was a strong anarchist against a lot of the usual things of our world. So behind the motifs, one of the main important things was to find out what were the good topologies, good strong topologies to understand what was going on with the motifs. The usual topologies were not good enough. The usual way to put topologies on algebraic objects like the Czariski topologies were too coarse. They were not very interesting in order to develop a good understanding of what was happening with the great mathematical problems. You remember that the greatest mathematical problem at the middle of the 20th century were the Weyl conjectures, in which André Weyl had introduced these general Riemann zeta functions for finite fields. And there he had proposed to construct the good cohomologies for that problem. He couldn't do it. Grothendieck did it thanks to his Grothendieck topologies. And one of them, famous Etal topology, was one of the keys to the answer. Deligne, one of his great students, finally solved the Weyl conjectures using those very fine, very, very refined topologies, which were new in that perspective, which were not seen from an analytical perspective, but only could be viewed and constructed from a synthetic perspective using the whole machinery of category theory in that moment. So on the left-hand side of the slide, you have something very technical, but that going back and forth is also very metaphorical. You have some sort of going back and forth between the reason and the heart, between what we could call analysis or set theory and synthesis and category theory. For emotional reasons, I put the corazón with category theory because this is what I love. But there are also some technical reasons in which the reason and the heart should be there. And what is interesting is the going back and forth, the ascent and the descent. Not to live only on set theory, or not to live only on category theory, but to work the modulations between them, to be systematically attracted to the modulations, to the differences, and to see what is going back and forth between them. In that sense, and looking at Warburg and Novalis and the motics idea, we should say that behind some stratigraphic multiplicity, sometimes, not always, of course, it depends always on the context. All of the things that I say, remember, are always relative. They are relative to a context. We have to be careful about the context. But we can say that vague things in one context give you a better understanding of the object in the context. So behind some kind of stratigraphic multiplicity, sometimes if you take seriously the idea of iteration of the form, then you get some kind of harmonic unity. It is the case with the motifs paradigm, in which the multiplicity of cohomologies taken together produce a harmonic unity with the motifs. And behind all this, then you have in the last sentence of this slide, you can look at new archetypes. This is very Grothendieckian. It's a general strategy of Grothendieck. One of the main and clear things that he could do mathematically is to show for the first time in history that the idea of number and magnitude come together from a general concept, which was the concept of a sheaf. The sheaf projected in some sense gives you the number, projected in another sense gives you the magnitude. You have algebra and topology coming from a general idea of a sheaf. That was a gigantic change, and it's going to take time probably. For shifts to influence and change our culture, but they will. I am certain that they will. It's such a simple and far-reaching concept that it will change things. So, very certain of it. So let's go to the atlas of transformation. This great understanding of our contemporary culture through a lot of visual diagrams. Yes, please. Okay. Yes. 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 No. Yes.
Believes that as a even you believe it is the point at which wrongly went too far.
Mm-hmm.
That there is generalized too far. There is no I'm wondering, regardless, suppose technically someone proved that it's actually possible to the generality of the world. Would that affect any of
No, I don't think so, because in fact, when we are doing the extrapolation of the technical mathematics to the vague idea, in there you don't have to be extremely careful about your context when you are in the vague paradigm. If you can do something, some of the mathematical constructions for some special categories of motives, that would work. You don't have to be so general in order to have all the possibilities. That would be a good example in order to be translated to the vague thing and then projected. That's more or less the idea. If you want to be very technical, probably some persons like Guerino Mazzola would like to do that very technically. That would be a good question for him on Saturday. I hope you will put that question on him and not on me. Yes. Yes, 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 of course. No, but that's completely correct, and that's very important also for our possible applications, that all the things, and as we have said several times, are some kind of blocked by good obstacles. The obstacles are extremely important. I think that sometimes the obstacles are even more important than the transitions and the possibilities of going beyond. So those limitations will be very certainly technically will be probably correct, but that will also should show us some things about those limits and how we should be careful about our generalizations. Yes. Okay, thanks. In this kind of beginning of a program that I am saying here, in that first translation, we have still for the moment, in time it should be more correctly done, but for the moment we have enough plasticity not to be working explicitly on some specific categories. Just with one working, that should be enough. So the people of the Atlas of Transformation systematically also have been saying that our visual age should be taken more seriously, and particularly on the idea of a diagram. You know very well that that was one of Peirce's central ideas. We think in diagrams for Peirce. But let's read some sentences of the Czech school, which are completely Persian in a sense. The use of a diagram enables us to create a new way of relating to the unknown, of unfolding the dynamics of orientation in the world. Again, when you read this sentence, after the things that we have been doing, we have been talking all the time about folding and unfolding, about how our world is completely disoriented, and we have to produce some kind of orientation. That can be done only if we take seriously the dynamics. We cannot be static in any ways. That can be done only if we go beyond the analytic, if we begin to think synthetically, but also not only analytically or synthetically, but horotically, on the middle ground, something that has never been done systematically. One should construct in time, seriously, a horotics, beyond analytics, beyond synthetics. In the middle ground, the things are the important ones. No one has ever really thought systematically about horotics. But the shift paradigm should help in that construction. So these sentences, which are very important for them, become now to be completely natural. This is this was one of my goals, to show that there is a complete naturality on some problems coming back at least from Novalis until today. The problems have always been there. The different approaches to the problem have changed. We have a lot of different perspectives. Can we glue some of them together? If they are coherent enough, can we glue them together? Can we put together in a good dialogue, Peirce with Warburg, with Florensky, with Novalis? I think so. This is the things that I have tried to do. A diagram can show a structure that is in movement or serves as a dynamic navigation tool of complex relations in the organization of knowledge and experience. That sentence could have been written by Christopher Vitali, could have been written by Guerino Mazzola perfectly. There are things which are coming together. We have to produce new navigation tools for complex relations in the world, for dynamic complex relations in the world, in which all these things could come together. But there, if there has been a mathematician, a great mathematician, in which movement, dynamic, relations, organization come together, that's exactly Grothendieck. So I think that it's a question of time. And we are in a very, very important time now. Grothendieck died last year. And Grothendieck will take every time more and more and more importance. And for the young people who are here, it's a fantastic moment. Fantastic moment to do new things. They are there. They have to be systematized. They have to, you have to go through a lot of strong work. But it can be done. Some characteristics of the diagrammatic thinking: to differentiate what is initially vague in a new way. Remember this strategy that we have. We have something which is theorematically very correct and very good. We produce something vague, we differentiate it. We have been doing that all the time. And then this produces some kind of topology, a change and transformation. And look at the main objective of diagrammatic thinking for the Atlas of Transformation people of the Czech Republic. How the structures of connectivity and separation, we would say here, how the structures of connectivity and non-separation are performed, evolve, and show forces of change. So change, the political change that Christopher Vitali is very interested in, should be produced by some kind of new structures of connectivity, in which our change, our evolution, produces a new topological understanding of things. For me, always, Peirce is like the giant genius. And the existential graphs are one wonderful, wonderful example of all these things coming together in very simple things. The existential graphs are extremely simple. In 1 hour, one can define everything that one needs of existential graphs. And in 2 hours, you can give all the basic proofs of the existential graphs, which go very far beyond. It is the only system that I know of, and I think it's the only system in general, it's not just my ignorance, it's the only system in logic in which you have exactly the same rules for the understanding of propositional logic, for the understanding of first-order logic, and for the understanding of modal logics. Exactly the same rules. The thing that changes are the languages, the objects for which we apply the rules, but they are exactly the same rules. If you have done some logic in the classical way, in the Hilbert style way, you see that the rules are completely different. They have nothing to do, the rules of propositional calculus and the rules of first order logic, the rules of modal logic, they are completely different. In fact, what Peirce showed with his existential graphs is that you have like an archetype, archetypical system of rules, which applied to the type of propositions gives you propositional logic, to the type of quantifiers gives you first order logic, and to the type of modal connectives gives you modal logic. It's something incredible, extremely little known. It's a pity because it's one of the greatest strokes of American inventivity in the history of thought. The Atlas of Transformation produces for us this beautiful, between a lot of beautiful and very interesting diagrams, this contraposition between day and night, between positive and negative. And if we look a little at the diagram, the diagram is have a lot of strange things. But if we look at some parts of the diagram, on the bottom part of the night part, you can see some of the things which have been fundamental for us here. Critical thinking, transitions, emotions, art, modernity, creative effects. All these things are on the night side, on the dark side, of course, on the negative side. The important things, in fact, are tend to be negative. So that's the idea of the negative combustion of Novalis, the idea of the decay of Negarestani, the ideas of Grothendieck to understand an object through its negative counterparts, the Lovier diagonal argument in which negation becomes the central construction of mathematics. These things seem to be really fundamental. And we are too much exposed in general to the daylight. Of course, you will follow me that in the daylight I put the analytic philosophy, and in the night part you put the synthetic philosophy. Much more interesting, the synthetic philosophy, than the analytical philosophy. Of course, I am a little joking about that. But the idea is that, in fact, the interesting things are in the negative part of this diagram, particularly the critical thinking, the transitions theory, and the emotions. Okay? We have been working on that a lot of time. So I was very happy to see that in the diagram, the Warburg idea is very well diagrammed. For Warburg, what was important was the depth, the negative part, the residue. The residue is in the negative part. In the good part, you have like the good landscape. Then in the negative part, you have like the real life, let's say. The negative part is also the imaginary part of the complex plane, and the day part is the real part of the line. There are a lot of analogies to be done there. Well, glass bead. Glass bead is a movement of young philosophers of art and artists in France and in England. It's very in the coming. They have been doing some performances and some colloquiums on their general idea, which is also a very simple and very beautiful idea, which is the following one. Art, and particularly art theory and art history, should help us to understand reason. Not the other way around, which is the classical one. Use reason to understand art. No, that has been done. We are not interested in that. We are interested in art helping us to understand reason. In that sense, the negative part helping us to understand the positive part, the day part. So they are looking for some kind of strategies, general strategies, to work around with this general concept of negative navigation. Let me read some of their sentences. Glass bead is conceived as a mode of collecting navigation within and across regional and often incompatible fields of knowledge. That has been extremely important for us, and it's extremely Grothendieckian. You have to be working across regions. Always, for Grothendieck, it was completely fundamental. You have to work in topology, algebra, functional analysis, geometry, logic, all the things together. And you have to try to put a nice navigation between these apparently incompatible fields of knowledge. In mathematics, they are not incompatible. And in fact, the mixtures are the important things in many of the great creative moments, say Riemann, say Poincaré, say Hilbert. When you begin to mixture the different regions, you are producing great mathematics. But you could say in principle that there is an incompatibility between contemporary art, I would say, the work of Rebecca Quitman. In fact, she signs R. H. Quaitman in order not to be herself, in order to fight against the me in herself. There are a lot of things which are very interesting, which are related to things which I have said, but I will not insist on that. In general, let's continue with some other sentences. Considering art to be crucial for the invention of vehicles able to navigate among heterogeneous and changing epistemic landscapes, Glassbead aims to bring disparate practices and ideas together in order to design complex transits between and within them. Again, this could be a sentence perfectly written by Negarestani, Mackay, or Vitali, or many people that were really interested in looking at the complex transits between, in principle, heterogeneous and changing epistemic landscapes. The idea of the glass bead is that art, as well as I have been saying, that mathematics provides already a lot of very, very useful, very interesting tools for the construction of that complex vehicles of navigation. The glass bead people is saying that art on their way should produce also these complex vehicles of navigation. When they come together, it will be extremely interesting. Is it possible or not? We don't know. It's a very young project. We will see what happens. Afterwards, we'll have Fabien Giraud here on Saturday to ask him questions about that idea. But if Pierre-Franc Castel's sentence is correct, that art and mathematics are the two major poles of invention of human thought, if one goes in both ways, and in both ways we provide good navigation tools, and in some moment those navigation tools cohere and they blend together, you imagine what I am going to say. We have a shift. So Glassbead is a research platform and a journal concerned with transfers of knowledge across art, science, and philosophy, but coming from art. That's the difference, coming directly from art. While Glassbead takes into account art's utopian drive to disconnect itself from historical contingent forms of rationality, it recognizes that this very process has participated in the construction of the space of reason. So in the space of reason, art is also extremely important. It should be taken seriously, and considers art to be a strategic way of engaging in its navigation and transformation. Probably the best example for us is Warburg. Warburg is a fantastic example of how the space of reason can be enlarged thanks to a history of art. His understanding of art has certainly enlarged and multiplied our understanding of the world, thanks to Warburg. And particularly his great idea that the residues can capture complex, very dense things around them, with a very systematic art history, and with this wonderful idea that in the Atlas of Mnemosyne, you have paths, new paths that emerge. Those new paths are related to thinking in a different way, topologically by paths and not by points. So Glassbead takes inspiration, of course, from Hesse's novel, The Glassbead Game, but there is a contrast for them. Contrasting with this overarching game, Glassbead aims to work in immanent relation to the material dynamics shaping epistemic constructions. As such, it is concerned with the construction of transformative relations between forms of knowledge that do not necessarily share the same space. So here you have really different leaves. You have the leaf of art, and in the leaf of art you have a lot of underleaves, or even if you want to be a little more strong with the metaphor, you have the Riemann surface of art. You have a lot of different leaves, in which, for example, you have in one of those leaves R. H. Quaitman's work, a very small thing in one of the gigantic leaves of art. But that very small thing is itself a Riemann surface, which can be represent the whole thing. Both beautiful iterations and reflections over there. But then you have the Riemann surface of art. You had also the Riemann surface of music, of course, of Riemann surface of poetry, or poetry, or mathematics, whatever. Can they be, at least conceptually, think together? Of course, mathematically, they cannot be linked together. But is it possible, at least, in order, what is the goal? The goal is to foster creativity, to produce new things, produce new understandings of the world. It seems to me that a strongly analytical perspective does not foster creativity. It seems to me that a vague, synthetic perspective fosters creativity in a much better way. There you have some of the diagrams. In particular, at the right, you have the Peirce's famous diagram of the labyrinth, in which you have the most complicated possible paths in order to begin to understand something, and probably you will never begin. So beyond Castalia, what they are thinking in their manifesto is really a multi-layered space. Let me read some of these things continuously, and for those who were here in the previous talks, you will see the echoes and the resonances all over the things that I have been saying. They say you have to consider a radical enlargement of the concept of sight. You have to produce a weaving dynamic relationships between the diverse conceptual apparatuses. You have to advance the exploration of a sight and the navigation of the manifold epistemic landscape it articulates. You have to construct the conditions for transits that transform the epistemic landscapes in which they operate. You have to engage, finally, with the mesh of local global transits that shape the epistemic landscape. So you have landscapes, and then you have to work around a general geometry of those landscapes with an enlargement. They say a radical enlargement of the concept of sight. But what has been more radical enlargement of the concept of sight, if not the Grothendieck toposes? Of course, they are the radical enlargement of the concept of sight. What have been the weaving dynamic relationships between diverse conceptual apparatuses, if not the functors of the theory of categories, etc., etc.? You have to explore a site, you have to navigate a manifold, you have to look for transits. They don't know, of course, neither Riemann nor Grothendieck, but it is time that we, at least as mathematicians, we begin to speak about those names beyond mathematics. I think it's extremely important. Their mathematics is very, very useful. And many of the great open problems are related to some of the ideas. That should change our culture also. Yes, please.
You've been speaking a lot in this lecture about the notion of a Riemann space.
Yes.
And the notion of a manifold.
Yes.
Being able to condense a variety of dimensions.
Yes.
And I noticed that you shifted from the language of sheets that you used previously. Now, if I'm understanding correctly, the in some sense, a generalization, a concept.
No, not exactly in that way, but they are very related in the following sense. Riemann surfaces were constructed by Riemann to unify the multiplication. And you have the exponential function, and then you have the logarithm function, the inverse function of the exponential. That inverse function of the exponential is not well defined because one point has a lot of images. So in order to produce a one-to-one correspondence, you introduce the Riemann surfaces. So the Riemann surfaces are related to inversion of functions of complex variables. Now, one of the main problems in the functions of complex variables is how you have some local information that you can spread over the complex plane. That's called the analytic continuation. And the analytic continuation and the shifts are exactly the same thing. That's true. the analytic continuation, the extension of the information that you have on some part of the Riemann surface to the whole Riemann surface is the problem of analytic continuation. The shifts of holomorphic functions are exactly the way to express in a modern perspective the analytic continuation property of the functions. So they are related, but they one cannot say that the shifts are a generalization of Riemann surfaces. What shifts are a generalization of the main problem of Riemann surfaces, which is how to extend your local information into a global information. Yes, yes, there is a very specific reason. I will give it in a second. Okay, yes.
Do you agree that still these aren't truly
concrete ideas until there's very specific concrete problem? Yes, the very concrete problem was always for them for him the Bell conjectures. It was a very specific problem, and thanks to that specific problem, he constructed the wall apparatus.
You see, once they were solved, they were noted. The noted seemed to be a generalization.
Once the specific concrete problem has been solved, it's all generalized and noted. Yes. There seems to be an obstruction. Yes, I think that the problem comes here. No, not here, but I will go quickly on this slide, and the problem comes in the following one. This is like, how do you understand the navigations? The navigation should be very, very ramified. You have a lot of logics. That's my first point. We are still too much concerned about classical logic, which has been extremely important because it is the natural logic of set theory, as I have explained several times. But in fact, there are a lot of other toposes, a lot of other spaces in which the natural logics are not classical. So there is a whole panorama of very interesting things in which navigation with different logics should be useful for this kind of people, for people in art, for people in poetry, in linguistics, in mathematics. They have been used sometimes, but they have still to be used a lot more. So this is the problem here. This is the problem in one figure that you cannot see very well, but then you will have the PDF of the slides to look afterwards well. The problem that Chris and you are pointing out is fundamentally the following one. Would it be possible to understand, thanks to the idea of shift, a generalized shift, of a generalized, like, I don't know how to put it, a generalized combustion of a shift or generalized, it's something that I cannot express very well because it's not clear for me either. The problem is the following one. You have these different Riemann surfaces that I have put on the board and in the borders, and which were related to very strong ideas of shift in Grothendieck, the emergence of the general theory of shifts, then the use of some particular shifts for the construction of schemes, the algebraic shifts, then the use of some topological shifts to the construction of toposes. The open problem that we don't know how we will understand in the future motifs as shifts. We don't know, no idea for the moment of how this is going to happen, or even if that is possible. But in general, then we could try to ask ourselves, if in mathematics the idea of a shift is so simple, I hope that after all the things that I have said in these talks, it's very simple. It's a very simple but very profound idea. It's the simplest possible object to produce the global by a local coherence of the local. With that, the only thing that you need are two topological spaces related to a projection. That's all the thing. That's a shift. It's very, very simple. It's the simplest mathematical object to try to formalize really well the constructions from the local to the global, and particularly to detect in that transit the obstructions. Because sometimes what is important is to see until where you can do, until where you can go. Some things which are fundamental in the complex variables are in the analytic continuation, not always you will be able to cover the whole Riemann surface. You will be covering just only one part of it. And there is a strong obstruction sometimes depending on the function that you want to generalize. So if the sheaf is a very, very fundamental object, and so fundamental, so profoundly fundamental, that both arithmetic and geometry come from it, number and magnitude come from it, is it possible to think what is the best basic idea to understand what is a sheaf, what is the, what I would call the nocturnal bottom of a sheaf in Warburg's sense, or what is the residue, the negative residue of a sheaf in the sense of Benjamin? What is the concept? What is the nocturnal bottom concept of a sheaf that will be so simple to spread over all our culture and to change our view of the world? Which is something which has happened in the history with the notion of point. The point has been so extremely influential, even if there are no points. It has been so extremely influential. We have the idea of an atom, something which cannot be decomposed. We have this idea of some things which are simpler, the simplest ones. The idea of a point has been extremely influential. There must be, probably, you know, perhaps one of some of you will know this soon. What is the extremely simple nocturnal bottom of the idea of a sheaf that will spread very simply over all our culture? That's the great question. It's a gigantic question, but it's a simple question. Very difficult question, probably. But when you will find the answer, it will be so simple. Everything will be extremely simple afterwards. Okay, I wanted to finish there. And I wanted to thank, of course, Christopher Vitali for this opportunity, and Pratt and the new Center for Practice and Research, which have streamed these things online. Thank you for all this. And thank you for your participation, which I was very impressed about. Extremely hard questions, very difficult questions, very bright questions, which have nurtured all these talks. Thank you. So we have still some minutes for questions if you want, but I will remember you to come for the, particularly for the round table from 6 to 9 on Saturday. And if you want to hear wrong things about me, you can come to Christopher Vitali's talk, who will be certainly more generous than he should be. Questions?
I would love to just to speak about, when you say transdisciplinarity, there's the question of disciplinarity, there's the question of specialization, and there's a lot of ways to talk about how fields collaborate, how it's so important for them to do so. But like, I mean, almost like as just vulgar and logistic as possible, like, should we get math degrees or get art degrees? You know what I mean? Like with the framework of what the academy is doing now, bureaucratically and so on, like, what would be the way to proceed? Because we know we can do transdisciplinarity, but like, what about the institution?
Yes. Okay. Yeah. That's an extremely important question. Several things around that. And the very prefix is important. I think it's very interesting to have the trans and not the inter. The interdisciplinarity and transdisciplinarity are things completely different. In trans, really, you want to live in the border. You want not to be here and here, but you want to live in the middle ground and to produce something new in the middle ground. That transition is very interesting. How to do that in our usual academies? I think that we have to fight against it in wise ways. I think that one wise way to do that is to have this goal of being really trans something. You can be transmodern or transspecial or transdisciplinary, whatever you want, transformational, this trans, but producing it in a very systematic way that you have that goal in mind. But in order to get that goal in mind, then you have to live as an academic. So you have to be a specialist in some time of your life, particularly when you are very young. I think it's still very interesting and very useful to be extremely good in a very little tiny part of the world, which has nothing, no importance, whatever. But that is a very, very good, way of forming oneself, but knowing very well that that will be only one part of your project, which is a much wider project. So if you have that in mind, you will not be deterred by things, or you will not go away from your perspective. But one lives in academia, and usually one has to live on his specialty. So one has to be one very good, knowledgeable person in some very little part of the world, so you can live about that, and you can progress the knowledge about this part of things. But if you have always in mind that that will be only a small residue, and what you want is the parts of the complete picture, that will be interesting. And I think that draws away a lot of our forces.
Do you think, you know, because in the world right now, yes, it is important to get to specialize intellectually, but right now, the transdisciplinary geniuses are like pretending to do one specialty just to get a job, or they don't have a job and they can't find a job. And like, can we like, in my head, I always blame the institutions for this. I'm like, oh, because the hiring programs are too slow and too dim-witted, you know, when I see that. But like, my main concern here, like, is with institutions and how we push that, you know, because that's not at the level of thought, that's at some other level.
Yes.
Pushing.
Yeah. Probably the things should go together, because I think that it's my perspective. I may be completely wrong, but I think that if you want to be trans in some moment, you have to be also be very good in some very specific things. You cannot be always trans. It's impossible. You have to be or a very good mathematician or a very good poet, very good artist, whatever you want, and then begin to make connections. It's important for oneself also, for our construction, because if you stay always in the between, finally the important thing is the in-between. But then you have to be, to have transited a lot, very careful things in one part of the world. I think that still is very important. But probably institutions should be so intelligent in the future, or so wider, to promote both things. To promote the extremely good specialization, but at the same time, to be opening our mind. That's Christopher Vitali reading of me. I am not at all. I am I am not a knowledgeable person of psychology or math. He is the one, and he is going to extend my ideas to a more wider even world. Christopher Vitali's mind is something completely crazy. If you know him, it's a person which is completely knowledgeable and useful person in the most technical, complex work of networks in modern literature, in Buddhist philosophy. So, and he's very knowledgeable in a lot of very different things. He has the ability of putting all of them together. I am not that one.
I hope that I will get your theories right, though.
you will. Yes.
I was wondering about the use of non-separation.
Yes.
Because the way that you're using it, you didn't just say that the structures ended up being non-separated as if it was not just a descriptive pattern, but somehow connected. I wondered if you could explain.
The non-separation comes from the previous lectures at the beginning, in which GROTHENDIECK invented new forms of topology which are non-separated in a following precise sense. If you have two points in the space, the topology is separated. If you have one neighborhood here and one neighborhood here, which are different, which don't have any intersection. So this is a separation property of topology. So GROTHENDIECK invented and discovered new structures, new topological structures in mathematics, in which that doesn't happen, in which these two points cannot be separated. They are really held together. So in that sense, GROTHENDIECK invented new forms of general topologies for the understanding of arithmetic and algebra, the Bell conjectures, things like that, in which the natural objects were non-separated. My idea then was, if that is happening with the sheaves, sheaves in general are non-separated, we can extrapolate that to a vague idea of non-separation of the disciplines in general, non-separation of politics and ethics and art and literature and poetry. They should be more welded together. So that's the idea. Pass to that vague construction of non-separation and then project it to the world. Yes, please.
You spoke earlier kind of about the relationship between art history and history in general. And I was just wondering if you could say a few things about how you see the relationship between history and
Yes, there are a lot of very interesting relations. History of mathematics, for example, is one thing that should be a lot more taught in our schools, in our colleges. It's one of the ways in which you can begin to enter in the conceptual world of mathematics in good ways, in which you go beyond the purely technical and formulaic aspects of algebra, of mathematics, which sometimes is the problem for the ones which are not mathematicians. It's too technical. The history of mathematics has this great, wonderful advantage in which the main ideas become purely conceptual. And there is a development of conceptual mathematics through history, which is extremely thoughtful. And the history of mathematics is certainly, I think, one of the things that should be more or less mandatory in any formation. It's the best way to understand mathematics. And most of us, even GROTHENDIECK, was driven to mathematics when he read a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful biography of Galois that perhaps you know. It was written by Leopold Imfeld, one of the collaborators of Einstein. He wrote a beautiful biography of Galois, and GROTHENDIECK in his reminiscences was recalling that he was driven to mathematics when he read that biography. In fact, that happens a lot. We see the great mathematicians, particularly Galois, this fantastic young genius, died at 20, changed completely mathematics afterwards, a passionate person, a true revolutionary, persons which are extremely interesting and which become like ideals for us, for the mathematician. any mathematician which comes to be a little closer to that giant, which is Galois, will drive his mathematics, will put strong emotions in his life. And so I think, yes, history of mathematics is one of the best ways to understand mathematics.
Sorry, but do you see some relationship between the history of mathematics and the history of art? Like, if Galois were born in a different time, it would be a lot of these ideas aren't
kind of seen. It's so strange because one can show, for example, using this kind of category theorematic things, one can show it's a theorem of theory of categories in the 60s, that if you want to have, let's say, a path, let's call it a morphism between two objects in a category, if you want to factorize that path in a very simple way, through some kind of projection and injection, then if you want to do algebra, then you have to introduce mandatorily, necessarily, it's a theorem, you have to introduce what are called the normal groups. And if you want to factorize in the category of rings, you have to introduce what are called the ideals. So Galois invented the Galois groups, the idea of normality in Galois groups in order to decompose analytically an object through its simple parts. But the history of mathematics shows us that if Galois didn't get the right notion at that time, someone would necessarily come with that notion because it's a theorem. That doesn't happen always, but that one is a particularly interesting theorem in mathematics in which it shows that Galois was fundamental, but his notion would have been necessarily invented in some moment of time. It's a theorem of category theory. So yes and no, Galois was fundamental, but if it wasn't Galois, it would have been some other people. But which is interesting for us in a more general perspective is that Galois is like the example of the great imaginative young person, a real pot of mathematics. I'm sorry, I didn't hear. Grothendieck himself was an explicit disciple of Galois. In many of his writings, he said, even in a semi-mystical way of thinking, he thought that he was like a continuation of Galois, a reincarnation of Galois in many senses. He says that in his famous Récoltant Semai work. So he was, in fact, understood like a heir of Galois. There was a heritage of Galois in which he was taking place. The change is in the way in which you look at the representation theorems or the objects in mathematics. For Galois, the Galois connections, the going back and forth, were related to very specific objects that he was inventing and introducing in that time. For Grothendieck, there is that general idea goes well beyond the objects. It goes to a whole new level, which are general categories. In those general categories, you work with collections of structures and functors between them. So it's, I think that it's clearly the Galois heritage, but in a new level of multiplication. Okay, thank you very much.